It is time for Savannah Lexicon. You are listening to WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings Community Radio with Global Soul. And I do appreciate you listening. This is Wayne. I am shifting gear now from Savannah Rising to Savannah Lexicon. And you're in for a treat today. This is going to be a good one. As regular listeners know, I often have politicians and city councilmen and women and social service organization folks and lots of serious stuff. And this is serious today insofar as it is theater. And that is a serious cultural endeavor, but this is really kind of for fun, too. I've got with me today folks from the Savannah Repertory Theater here based in Savannah. I guess the newest, I think, theater company in the city. And they are going to do this very evening at the Play Shop. At 7 o'clock this very evening, they are going to do the first presentation of Jacob Marley's Christmas Carol. Okay, and it's going to go for 2 weekends. So this is going to be good. They're going to do little snippets for us. They're going to do 2 or 3, hopefully 3 little snippets from the play. So this should be good. This should be good. No doubt about it. This should be good. Welcome to everybody. Y'all doing okay?
We're doing great.
Okay. Let's see. Everybody doing good today?
Great.
Okay. All right. Excellent. Excellent. All right, so Artistic Director Ken Neil Haley, how are you, sir, particularly today?
I'm doing fine.
You're doing good as well. All right, you are the Artistic Director
for this. Artistic Director.
The founding, founder, Artistic Director, and all-around...
crazy person.
Crazy person, okay. He said it. I did not. I'm only repeating his words. By the way, we do have a little piece of business to take care of before we go any further, and regular listeners know this. This is the world-famous general disclaimer. The viewpoints expressed in the following program are not necessarily those of WRUU, its license holder, or its staff. All right, that is my, I don't know what that is, that's my professional disclaimer voice. So there, we got that out of the way. Now we can talk a little bit about this production, about the company, and all of that thing. So let's just start talking about the company just a little bit before we get into this particular production.
Okay.
You've been around for about a year, is that right?
We came in and did experimental productions starting in February, and we have our own space. We are now in our 5th production.
Okay.
In 1 year, and I'm looking forward to a little break, which won't happen until the summer. So anyway, but we started out upon the closing of a company that I was the artistic director of, Kentucky Repertory Theater up in Bowling Green and around the Mammoth Cave area.
Okay.
When that company closed because they lost their building, we had a really great core group of actors and directors who started looking for a place. The very first place, because I've been coming here for about 15 years now. My first time here was at 9/11. The month after 9/11, we had to come in for a wedding. And I said, let's go check out this town.
Okay.
And I've been coming back ever since. This place. And when we were... looking for a place to open the new company. The first place I said was, let's check out Savannah. Mm-hmm. Although we know they already have an equity professional company down there. But we came in and lo and behold, there wasn't. There are 2 really great local companies.
Right.
Or 3 great local companies, including the Children's Theater, that really up the game as far as material that we can do. And So we decided to give it a go, and then things have just fallen into our lap. The first time we were looking around, a space opened up for us. It used to be the Dollhouse
right.
Sound Studios. They are actually still there, operating.
Okay.
It's just that we control the rest of the building now.
Okay.
And
what is that address there?
That is 980 Industry Drive.
Yeah, and tell us a little bit where that is exactly.
It is, you go out, that's out Liberty, until you pass the old Seaboard Station.
Okay.
You turn right on Latham,
mm-hmm.
and then you turn right on Industry Drive. We'll have signs out there and everything, because it is a little bit hard to find.
Yes, it is. I think most people in Savannah, I mean, theater goers and theater lovers probably know, but still, that is an odd address that when you say Industrial Drive, people say, where is that? I don't know where Industrial
they
Drive
do.
So, yeah.
I've drawn many a map.
Yes, I bet. Okay. All right. Good deal. And just a nutshell bio on you. You told us a little bit. You were at Louisville.
I have
Bowling
worked
Green,
at Louisville, but this was down
Louisville.
In Bowling Green. It was Kentucky Repertory Theater.
Mm-hmm.
I was an actor like everybody else in this group, and then just decided to focus more on directing. Then started deciding I wanted my own company.
Yeah.
And then have partnered with some great people. A family, the Bishop family, who've been backing everything, and they have two kids who are very talented, who also run. Basically, we're the three partners.
Yeah. Okay.
And then the parents are there with the checkbook, so which is the important part, of course.
That's a nice thing. Yes, that's.
So we found this
how
place.
We operate. Although there's no one, we don't have one particular person like that. But I mean, in terms of just, you know, getting the funds to manage to be open and continuing to go on. Yeah.
So, but we came down here, and just the amount of material that we can do, the kinds of material that we can do, was very attractive. Plus, just walking down the street here, people I've walked on, Nick Corley, our co-director here, who's the director of the show, was walking down with me one night, and the first walk through Savannah, here's this place. We can have this as a theater. We can have this as a, we can have this as a place to live. So he already started spotting things in the place on his first trip through town.
With great architecture, I'll tell you that.
I'm telling you, this town's easy to fall in love with. You said you visited here a number of times and fell in love with it. That's an easy thing to do.
It is.
Savannah is an easy city. All right, and so Nick, you are the director of this particular production, and otherwise you are just an all-around
man about town.
Well, that's probably better than crazy guy. So I might go with that. All right. So tell us just a little bit about this particular production, because we all know, A Christmas Carol, one of the mainstays of the Christmas season, and a heartwarming tale indeed. But you guys have taken, and you particularly have taken a little twist on this. So tell us, explain to us a little bit about this particular production.
Well, the piece actually started at the Goodman Theater in Chicago.
Okay.
And there was an actor who was in the show, and for many, many holidays, seasons, and he decided to write a version based on Jacob Marley's perspective. So what is Jacob Marley doing while Scrooge is looking around and seeing his world and making his changes to his life? What's the Jacob Marley backstory that surrounds all this? So he came up with this really clever idea, and the show premiered actually as a book that he sold in the lobby, and people bought it, and it got all sorts of recognition. And then the artistic director there said it should be turned into a play. So it was performed first as a one-person play where he was performing his novel, much like Charles Dickens did with Christmas Carol.
Yeah.
He would often perform that as over the holidays. So, and then it grew into a four-person show, and we're actually the first people to do it as a five-person show, which is unique to Savannah.
So you added a character.
We added a character. I'm reading it, I felt that they had the same actor playing everyone from Mr. Fezziwig, who's an older energy, and then you have Bob Cratchit, who's this younger energy, and I wanted to have more energies of those two different people separated out for the show.
Okay.
I thought it was more interesting, and there's also because we're doing it in an extreme thrust, which means the audience is kind of in the play with the actors.
Okay.
And that means having a few more people to cover more things, because you just can't go off into the wings and change your clothes and come back. The nature of how we're doing it, making it more of an environmental production, required one more actor, and I think it's really exciting this way.
Excellent.
When he told me I was in it, he said, we need an old guy. So he wasn't very subtle at it.
I said we need an old crazy guy.
that's me.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
I have one of those in stock.
We need an old crazy guy. Okay. Well, if you ever need an old, crazy, bald guy with no acting experience,
you're hired. You're in.
You never know.
Maybe on Friday night, things don't go well tonight.
Okay. All right. That sounds interesting. Okay. Let's also introduce the rest of the gang here. Guys, our small little WRUU studio is jam-packed with repertorians, and it's quite a sight. And, okay, so you guys, just one at a time, tell us, if you would, your name and what your association is with the theater and or with this particular play.
Well, I'm Gerald Draper, and I'm playing Jacob Marley.
Okay, Gerald. Good.
I'm Jack Hareholt, and I'm playing the Bogle, which is Jacob Marley's little demon follower who helps him throughout the play.
Right, okay.
And I'm Kevin Zeff. I'm playing Scrooge.
Oh, Scrooge. Yes. We got Scrooge here, folks. I don't know about that. All right. That sounds interesting. Okay. Are we ready, for the first little bit? And what kind of a setup do we perhaps need for this?
Well, this is early on. The first piece is early on in the show. And Jacob Marley is being shown by Bogle, who's this character that's unique to this production. Well, not so much to this look at Christmas Carol through this other perspective. And he's leading Jacob Marley around, and they have this clever plot twist, and which I won't give away, but they need to make Scrooge see things differently. And that's their effort. And this is kind of a scene towards the beginning.
Okay. All right. All right. Gentlemen, whenever you are ready, you may proceed.
It was London, on a crisp market morning at the fish market in Billingsgate. The streets and alleys close by the river were filled with shouting, whistling, singing, and swearing men. The tremendous noise they made, the confusion, the din was awesome, and in a way, somehow splendid and grand. Disgusting, isn't it? Messy. How can they all live like that? Each in each other's face, each in each other's business, like some big meddling intrusive...
Why are we here? I don't see what's to be gained here. I've seen all this before.
Have you? Well, perhaps you've never noticed this.
Molly felt a bit dizzy, and as he blinked hard to clear his vision, the population before him doubled, tripled, for beside every man there stood a spirit, if not two or three. Some watching in horror, others bemused, others laughing, helping, whispering encouragement. All interested, all caring, all intensely involved.
Crowded? What?
What are they doing?
Nothing much. Spectators at a cricket match, cheering the home team, occasionally offering a little help. Bright idea, kind word, pat on the back.
Did I have help? Companions like that?
Legions. You were a special case. At one point, you literally had 138 angels dancing on the head of your particular pin. But you outlasted them. Finally, they all got discouraged and moved on to more promising projects. Axe murderers and the like. Unfortunately, I was stuck.
Well, I never asked for your help. Consider yourself unstuck. If you're so unhappy, go, be gone. I liberate you. Trouble yourself no longer. You're free.
Not so easy, old puddin'. I'm here for the duration.
All right. There you go. I like it. I like it already. That's good.
It's unique writing. It's very story theater where the actors are... are actors within the piece, and they're narrating in addition to playing characters and switching around and moving the scene
yeah,
and stuff.
So exactly. I noticed
it's very
that.
RSC.
Yeah. Yeah. Wait a minute. Very what now?
Royal Shakespeare Company.
Yes. You see. You have to tell us theater.
All right.
us theater idiots what that means.
It became very big in theater when Nicholas Nickleby came over from London, because that was also Dickens.
Mm-hmm.
And,
Dickens, right.
Use that style of theater to weave their tale.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
We're
so
good
yeah.
hands with it.
Yeah, you
We're
change.
We're also really lucky to have Nick on it, because to say that he is a Christmas Carol expert is a bit of a understatement. He did
I did 8 years over a 10-year span, playing Bob Cratchit in a Christmas Carol at Madison Square Garden in an intimate 5,000-seat theater. But it was a big musical version with music by Alan Menken, who, of course, did Beauty and the Beast and many other scores that people will know. And it was a wonderful time every
played
year.
It with
I
about
bet it was.
Every A-list actor known to man went through that production over the 10 years.
It was great. We had Jim Dale and Frank Langella and, you know, F. Murray Abraham.
Wow.
F. Murray Abraham was very funny. He used to, as a joke, F. Murray Abraham likes to hide his Oscar
okay.
on the set in various places. So
really?
You never know where it would show up. So one day we're doing the show and I opened my poor Cratchit family's, you know, cabinet to see what we have to eat, which is nothing, and there was an Oscar in it. So I quickly closed the cabinet. You know, but we love F. Murray. He's a great guy.
It's the first time I've heard him doing that somewhere else. I worked with him in a show at the Jewish Repertory Theater in New York, and it was a two-man show called The David Mamet Piece, A Life in the Theater. And he brought his Oscar like he always does. It's his good luck charm that he hangs out with in the dressing room.
Oh, is that what he says?
Yes.
And he left it behind for about a month and a half.
Whoa.
Well, I was going through in the office one day. I opened the drawer and here's an Oscar.
Hmm.
And yes, it did manage to make its way into a few pictures.
I bet. Man, I would not leave an Oscar behind. I don't think I would do that. Now that's interesting. So you played that, you played Cratchit for how many years in a row?
I did it for over a span of 10 years. I did 8 seasons. I was away for 2 seasons in the middle.
And how long a run at a time?
We would do, well, the show was 90 minutes with nonstop music telling the Christmas Carol story and a beautiful, beautiful version of it. That was huge. And, we would do 15 shows a week.
Okay.
So we would do 4 on Fridays, 4 on Saturdays, and 3 on Sundays.
Wow,
so it was
that's
always
tough.
Time for Christmas Carol.
Good old Radio City
I
schedule.
Mean, yes.
I'm exhausted just hearing that.
Did you find yourself, I mean, as the Christmas holiday time started coming forward, did you just find yourself automatically, even before the show, just falling into a Cratchity kind of
always it's such a wonderful story, and the story itself, it's very interesting. Christmas was kind of in a wane during the early Victorian era, and it was really the writing of this novel that turned Christmas into the holiday as we know it now.
That's interesting.
It was so much became about it. It was because there's a lot of pagan traditions and things, and the church was deciding. But it's really Dickens' novel that really made it about gatherings of family and put that value back into the holidays, and looking after other people as part of the holidays, the Christmas cards and all that. It became huge because of this. If not for this novel and the popularity, I don't know if Christmas would be the same as it is now. So it's very influential, this piece of writing. He was really moved deeply to write it. He was going to write a pamphlet because it was a depression era
right
at the time, and he was moved by seeing all the kids in the workhouses.
Mm-hmm.
He had his father had lost everything, and he was put into a workhouse as a child.
Right,
so
exactly.
He wanted to do something to bring that plight forward. He was going to make a pamphlet and put that out. And instead, he was inspired to write this. And he would wander the streets of London all night long coming up with the story. And then he'd go home and write it. He wrote it very quickly. And he self-produced it. He was in a riff with his publisher. But he wanted it to be affordable. So he made it very affordable. But he made it very expensive pages and stuff because he wanted it to be a beautiful thing. And he didn't make a ton of money, but he made enough to help with his situation, and it became a huge hit. So
Excellent.
It's a lovely holiday thing.
It is. I'm happy he was able to fund it himself. That's remarkable in and of itself, really. Yeah. But excellent. Yeah, because we take this so much almost for granted now.
Yeah.
I mean, the story in the sense that it's just such an integral part of the Christmas holiday season. And yeah, I mean, it's just one of the mainstays that you know about. So, but it's also interesting, which makes it that much more interesting that you guys put a little twist to it.
Yeah.
You know?
And you do see the classic Christmas Carol story within the body of this piece.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Sure. Oh, yeah. I mean, that was even evident from the first, you know.
Yeah.
Our second act.
Our second act is the weaving of that Jacob's story through, but you get the whole Christmas past, present, and future story within it also.
Yeah.
You meet, see the Cratchit dinner, all sorts of things. In fact, we have, if you want, we have a scene that's more Scrooge and Marley. And it's more the traditional Christmas Carol narrative.
Okay, well, yeah, let's. We might as well move on. To a second scene that'll take us really right to break. So that might be good, and then we can come back and talk a little bit more, and then do a third scene before all is said and done. Right? Three?
Yeah.
We can do three? Yeah. Okay. All right. So
what are we
looking at here? Any setup on this scene that we're going to?
This is so classic.
Oh, okay.
I think everyone will immediately know these two and what's up.
Okay. All righty. Great. All right, gentlemen. As you wish.
Scrooge. A death rattle whisper outside Scrooge's door. Then crash, lock shattered, wood splintered, and inside the door, inside the room, with a terrible howl, the fearful, hideous, green glowing figure of Marley's ghost.
Empty. The room was empty. Wonder if I could have gotten the wrong room, made a mistake. It is pretty dark after all.
The poker passed right through Marley, and the lack of resistance threw old Scrooge off balance before he could regain his equilibrium.
Marley floated out of range and turned. The two old men just stood still, frozen for a moment, staring at each other.
What do you want of me?
March!
Scrooge charged again, screaming and swinging the poker. It slashed through Marley again and again, having no more effect than it would have had on Smoke.
Marley stood his ground and laughed a hollow, ghostly laugh.
Who are you?
Ask me who I was.
Very well. Who were you, then?
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
Jacob Marley? Well, Can you sit down?
I can.
Well, do it then. Nothing was said for a while.
For a while, the two old men just sat in silence, glowering at each other.
For Scrooge and Marley had never been friends. Instead, they were partners. Years of mistrust and resentment bound them together, naught affection.
So they sat staring at each other in silence.
He's not really seated on the chair. He's actually floating an inch or two above the chair. That's nasty.
How's business?
It's fine, fine, as well as could be expected, I suppose. I got a new safe.
New clients, new accounts?
A few. It goes 7 years.
Ah.
And you?
You don't believe in me.
I don't!
Why do you doubt your senses?
Oh, any little thing affects them. Undigested bit of beef, fragment of an underdone potato, etc., etc. Humbug, that's what you are. Hey, humbug!
With a terrible wail, Molly rose from his chair and floated hideously in the air above Scrooge, clanking his chains and howling.
The old man shrank, gasping.
Molly floated until his face was inches away from Scrooge. Then he peeled the flesh off his skull like a banana and howled at the old man. Man of worldly mind, do you believe me or not?
I do, I must.
Good.
Sit down then.
Very well. Marley put his face back on as calmly as if he were adjusting his glasses and floated back to the chair.
Those chains. You're fettered. Why? I wear the chains I forged in life. I made them link by... I made them link by link, yard by yard, cash box by cash box. Is the pattern strange to you, or would you know the weight of the chain you bear yourself? It was full and as heavy and as long as this 7 Christmases ago, and you have labored on it since.
So why do you trouble me? I'm sure you just didn't drop by to be sociable.
Oh, I've come to warn you, you must change.
Change, eh? Change what?
You must have a complete and willing change of heart, Ebenezer Scrooge.
Oh, I must I?
You must.
And that's what you came here to say?
It is.
Oh, I see. Well... good enough. Thank you. Consider it changed. Evening.
But I...
Oh, I'm much obliged to you, sir. Thank you kindly. Good night.
Oh, excellent. Excellent.
All right. Very nice. Wow. So the accents, I mean, that's great. And then the way that you... You know, I mean, you just voice different ages and different styles. It's amazing, you know, to somebody like me to just see that, particularly to see it this close up like this and you guys just in your street clothes. And it's amazing.
Well, I have to say, we're very, very fortunate to have the cast we have here. They're a tremendous group of actors, and it's been such a pleasure to work with them. They're joyous.
Yeah. Absolutely amazing. All of you, and you're changing your voice as you go. I don't know. It's a mystery to me. How is this done? I don't know. It's the art of acting is what it is, which I have never tried. Well, let me see. There was that fifth grade, you know, thing in school where I was a tree, but other than that, that was pretty easy.
Started out as trees.
Yes. I was an elm.
All right. Gosh, well, we'll come back and talk a little bit about that scene and other stuff, too. I do have to take a brief pause for the cause. You are listening, by the way, to Savannah Lexicon here on WRUU, and we are with the Savannah Repertory Theater, whose production of Jacob Marley's Christmas Carol is starting tonight at 7 p.m. at the Savannah Rep Play Shop, just to be precise. Okay. And we will be back with them and more, and they have got yet another exciting scene to do out of this production before it is all said and done for the day. Let me let you know, you are listening to WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM. We are Savannah Soundings Community Radio with Global Soul.
This portion of WRUULP Savannah Soundings programming is made possible by a grant from Brighter Day Natural Foods, offering produce, vitamins, and supplements, and a deli and juice bar. Brighter Day is located at 1102 Bull Street at the south end of Forsyth Park. More information available at 912-236-4703 or brighterdayfoods.com.
All right, and let me tell you this. Savannah artists are raising money for Puerto Rico with an art sale on Saturday, December 16th, 2017, 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. The art sale is sponsored by Asbury Memorial United Methodist Church at 1008 East Henry Street, Savannah. Everything raised in this sale will go to UMCOR, with all proceeds for Puerto Rico relief. They are still having a time there, folks. We should not forget them. And let me also mention this. While I got you, real quick, if your business enjoys our programming on WRUULP, please support the station with a donation. Let your customers, neighbors, and friends know that you share our vision of building a thriving community based on diverse, vibrant radio programming. As a business partner, our listeners will know you support Savannah's only broad-based community radio station. Become a Tower sponsor or underwriter to check out the levels of corporate sponsorship and to donate. Go to www.wruu.org/business. Again, to check out the levels of corporate sponsorship and to donate, go to www.wruu.org/business. Thank you for listening to and supporting WRUULP. Thank you for listening to and supporting Savannah Lexicon here this fine morning. So, guys, that was excellent. Scrooge,
yes.
You're a mean old man.
You
are a nasty old coot indeed. Absolutely. excuse me. So I guess this has the best of both worlds in the sense that it is such a well-known, beloved Christmas play that everybody knows and loves, and yet again too you've managed to put a fresh twist to it, so it's not just the same old. Even if we love something as much as the Christmas Carol, it's you know, at Christmas time, every Christmas after Christmas after Christmas after Christmas, you know, you can even get a little jaded with it, even as if we do love it. So putting a new twist on it like this, I think, is a great idea, and well done.
Thank you. I want to say that it's a cast of five, and we're missing one today.
Yeah, who are we missing?
Steve Wilson, who is an absolute delight as Bob Cratchit and various other people.
Wow.
Couldn't be with us today, but there will be five actors actually on stage.
Okay.
As dangerous as that sounds.
Even another. That does sound dangerous, by the way.
Marquise is one of our locals, as are Gerald and Kevin. But Gerald and Kevin are a little different. They just moved here, but they have been professional actors. They've been out in the profession. Marquise is brand new and just making his first steps into
He's
it.
He's a SCAD student.
SCAD student.
Yeah, and terrific.
Undergrad or grad?
I think undergrad.
But that's been one of the things that we do, is we're calling ourselves a stepping stone company for those who want to jump into the profession. The first thing we do when we're casting is we try and find any regional professionals, any area professionals that we can. These two guys just showed up at auditions. We had no idea they were coming. It was like, okay, you're captured now. We have nets that come down. But we mix these people with New York professionals who come in, which is where Jack falls into it.
Right. Okay.
So I'm really lucky in that I get the best of both worlds. I'm spending now half of my time here in Savannah and half my time in New York City in my neighborhood of Astoria, which is like one of the coolest neighborhoods up there.
Yeah. Not a bad life.
Sesame Street. They make Sesame Street at the movie studio three blocks from my house.
Is that right? Okay. All right. let me just back up real quick for a minute. And we're missing a member again. Tell me the name again.
Marquise D. Wilson.
Okay, and he plays Cratchit and
plays
some other
Cratchit
other
and
roles as well.
He plays assistant and various other people. There's the role that's been divided up to create these two roles.
Right.
Was a part that played many different characters throughout the show. So
he's
kind
now
of fun. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Excellent. Excellent. Well, you know, I hate that he's missing it, but at the same time, one more person in here, we might be bursting at the door. The door might be, you know, knocked out into the hallway there. Okay. All right, excellent. Now, describe the theater just a little bit to me. I mean, is there, what can we talk about, the size or the...
It is an old warehouse space.
Right.
That we're keeping it in the rough. There was a stage in there when it was more of a music venue that was used part-time. We've removed that stage so that we can put up a stage whenever we need to.
Uh-huh.
Where this show is done in a very long, what's called three-quarter round configuration.
Uh-huh.
The last show we did, which was a brand new script of Guess Who's Coming to Dinner based on the film, we did that, but it was an environmental piece. So literally everyone in the audience was sitting in the middle of the living room of the Drayton family. So we keep it so that, and what we're doing the next time is going to be kind of out of this world. It's not a family show. It's called The Lieutenant of Inishmore, that is written by the gentleman who directed and wrote the film that's big out there now, Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri.
I want to see that so bad. I love the look of that.
It's great, but be prepared that it is, it's not a drama. It is a comedy. It's the same way with The Lieutenant of Inishmore. We kind of picked it so that it would kind of associate with St. Pat's Day, but was not necessarily a St. Pat's piece.
Oh, okay.
It's about a guy who is an operative for the IRA, but was kicked out because he's too violent for them. And he has one Achilles heel, which is he loves his cat. And he finds out that his cat may have been accidentally killed, but he comes back with revenge on his mind, and hilarity ensues. We are literally building the set over our loading dock. We're building it there so that we can spray off the... so that we can just, after every performance, spray off the stage blood. We're figuring about 4 gallons of stage blood a night.
Wow. So this obviously is coming this coming spring,
I
guess.
March 1st.
Right. Yeah,
that won't be the Christmas.
That won't be. That's not the Christmas.
No Christmas show there. No. All right, excellent. And so you guys, I'm sure a goodly number of folks can fit out there. So you're
it seats around 100 people.
Yeah,
and
okay.
This cool old warehouse factory. It was originally the Sunshine Bakery, I believe.
Really?
Here in town. And
okay.
It's been everything from that to a cryogenic storage facility to a
really?
Warehouse door, a building facility to the dollhouse, and now we share it with the dollhouse, and it's a really a fun venue to see a show in.
Okay.
We keep one of the doors with, it's covered with old bills from the cryogenic supply house.
Oh, my gosh.
Tell me about that.
Seriously? Really?
Yeah, seriously.
Are y'all making this up?
Yeah.
No, you're real.
Yeah.
A cryogenic place was out there.
They weren't storing people. It was just the stuff.
Not the people.
Okay. All right. Because if they were, if they had the people out there, y'all might have just scared everybody out.
Yes.
So they were just building the material and the technology,
to do that
crazy.
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll talk to Disney about that.
All right. Now, if people wanted to, make you guys aware of them, I guess that you guys are open. They could go to the website if they so chose to do so, and at any rate, contact you guys in terms of opportunities.
Auditioning. Do on our website have an audition section that will give you all of the information that you would want whenever it's coming up. We actually do have a set that's coming up now. It's at savannahrep.org.
Right.
But we do have all of the information on the show, all of the dates and everything that you need for this one. We're doing the midweek shows at 7 o'clock, and then on the longer weekend, we actually go back to the 8 o'clock, the normal time.
And you're talking about this show now?
That's the show here.
Right.
We're just doing the Thursday night this week, and Wednesday and Thursday next week is a little earlier to accommodate families.
Right. Okay.
Why? We won't be doing that on Lieutenant of Inishmore.
Okay. All right. Okay, we got one more scene, right? Another scene?
One more. This takes place when traditionally Christmas present comes to take Scrooge on that part of his journey. And it ends with the traditional wanton ignorance under the thing. Mm. But before that, he takes him and shows him the beauty of families being together and what family means in a more universal sense. And this is that section of the show.
Okay.
They traveled then, the four of them. Scrooge tiny and protected in the spirit's great hand. Marley and the Bogle enfolded in the spirit's great heart. They traveled the world that night, and both Scrooge and Marley saw many things they had never seen, or had avoided seeing, or had seen and then forgotten.
In two old women sitting before a fire, laughing together till all the tears ran down their faces over the loves of their youth.
And a pair of lovers, whispering their love and fearfully, desperately, gravely touching each other for the first time, or the thousandth.
In neighbors coming together,
helping a woman to bury her husband, or her father, or her child, weeping with her, sharing her grief and her burden.
And a man stopping his work, taking a child onto his lap and teaching the child how to tie a knot, or read a word, or make something again and again until the child proudly accomplished it on his own.
In one of the almshouses, on this night of all nights, the Bible reader, leaving off the dour stern threats and lectures and instead retelling the poor the story they all knew. How on a certain night, like all nights, a child was born and a star heralded its coming, and it was visited mother and child by friends and neighbors bringing gifts of love and welcome. They saw all this and more in their travels that night.
And Scrooge learned much.
But it was Jacob Marley, within the spirit, seeing with his eyes and feeling with his heart, who learned the most.
Ah, Merry Christmas indeed. Bravo, bravo. Hey. Excellent, guys. Excellent. This is nice. I like to do this kind of thing. This time of the year particularly, bring you guys in. I hope that everything goes well with this. Let's give it one more time. The website is
savannahrep.org.
And the shows are?
This weekend, they are Thursday, Friday, and Saturday afternoon. So the evenings and Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 7 o'clock and 8 o'clock on Friday and Saturday. Mm-hmm. Then next weekend, we do a Wednesday and Thursday. That is 7 o'clock.
Okay.
And then 8 o'clock on Friday and Saturday, and 3 o'clock for both. No matinee on the second day. That's Christmas Eve.
Right. Yes. We do have a Sunday show this weekend.
Yes. We do have a Sunday show this weekend.
Okay.
3 o'clock. 3 o'clock. Excellent. The address again is
980 Industry Drive.
Okay, which is the dollhouse and the play shop location. Actually, play shop is you guys part of it. And much success. I hope it does well. You guys are great, man. Absolutely nice. It was nice having that in here this morning. I'm very much more in the Christmas spirit now.
Thank you for having us.
Especially that ending. I love that that y'all chose that as the last little bit there. So much success with it, listeners. We are going to take a short break as we do, and I move into the last segment here of the show where I just tell you about some things going on in the city and some things you might want to be aware of and all that kind of good stuff. As you know, I quite often have a little musical interlude in the mix just to kind of keep you around, so we kind of make the shift. So, and Savannah Repertory Theater, thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Appreciate
thank you.
It.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays to y'all as well. All right, I appreciate you sticking with me here on Savannah Lexicon this fine, fine morning. The last segment here, y'all, before we have to stop things for the day. But don't you worry, following me at 9 o'clock is Background Briefing, an excellent show that takes a national and international spin on things. Savannah Lexicon, as you know, is very community and local-oriented. Background Briefing at 9 spreads the perspective, as does at 10 o'clock Democracy Now! With the indefatigable Amy Goodman is coming up. So there's nothing but good stuff. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I believe that we may have some Christmas music with Brian after that. So there's nothing but good stuff here. So just keep on listening. Also, want to go ahead and make sure you know what's coming up next week here on Savannah Lexicon. On Tuesday, my guest will be Goodwill Vice President of Community Engagement, Cynthia Barnes. We'll be here next Tuesday, and we'll talk about the continuing good work that Goodwill does in this season of goodwill. And next Thursday is going to be another very special Christmas show. Still kind of making, putting it all together to make sure what we have, but I believe we're going to have the Unitarian Universalist Church's Reverend Dave Messner, and who is going to come in and talk about the fact that James Pierpont, the songwriter who wrote Jingle Bells, of course, did so here in Savannah, and he was a music director for the Unitarian, not Universalist at the time, no Universalist there, but Unitarian Church of Savannah in the mid-19th century. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I think we're going to maybe try and have a little, some other kinds of either Christmas readings or Christmas music kind of thing going on. That's going to be on the 21st next Thursday, so we'll be getting very close to the big day at that point. So we want to do some sure enough Christmas stuff on that show's date. Now, what's going on in this fine city? All kinds of good stuff. Some of it fun, some of it serious, you name it. First off, I just want to remind you that Skate Fest 2017 is going on. Daily 90-minute ice skating sessions at a very reasonable price at the Civic Center, 301 West Oglethorpe Avenue. That's going on from now through January 1st, actually. So that's going on, and all sorts of other Christmas stuff will be as well. Starting tomorrow, I believe it starts tomorrow, yes, 7:30 p.m. and Saturday, excuse me, at 2 p.m. and 7:30 p.m., Black Nativity, A Christmas Tradition. This is from the Performing Arts Collective of Savannah, and it's a Christmas musical written by renowned African-American author Langston Hughes. And it's a retelling of St. Luke's story of the birth of Christ. It's got gospel music, it's got dance, poetry, all sorts of stuff. On Saturday, Holidays at Fort Pulaski. It's going to be festively decorated. There are going to be guided fort tours, cannon demonstrations. There will be living historians, family-friendly kind of thing on December 16th and 17th, Saturday and Sunday, 10 a.m. through 3 p.m. at Fort Pulaski National Monument. Let's see, what else? Also on Saturday, there will be the Reindeer Run and Holiday Market. This is a benefit for the Rape Crisis Center in town. No doubt a very good cause here. It will benefit the prevention education program of the Rape Crisis Center. The Reindeer Run and Holiday Market is 9 a.m. starting at the Trade and Convention Center. Not a free event, but of course it's a fundraising kind of thing. So you can go to events at rccsav.org. Very worthwhile Christmas activity going on there. Also, excuse me, Saturday, December 16th, 6:30 p.m., the 7th Annual Homegrown Holiday Hoedown at the American Legion Post, 135 Ballroom. And the tickets are at brownpapertickets.com. And that is an event that is 21 and older. Also, this happens to be the third Saturday and Sunday of the month. So on River Street, Unity in the Community is going to be down on River Street, and they're going to have handcrafted ethnic arts and crafts, and community nonprofits will be on display, and all sorts of things going on there. That's kind of Christmassy. Also Sunday, Sunday the 17th, Carols for a Cause. Now, this is really something. Free and open to the public at Christ Church Episcopal, 28 Bull Street, 7 p.m. on Sunday. Emmett Cahill, I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, an Irish tenor, will be featured. Also, Savannah Children's Choir and Savannah Brass Quartet. The donations are benefiting the Emmaus House, which is a wonderful nonprofit social service organization here in town, who I've had the pleasure of having a representative here on my show. So again, it's free, but donations are certainly appreciated, and they benefit Emmaus House. That's Carols for a Cause. 7 p.m. Sunday, Christ Church Episcopal, 28 Bull Street. Emmett Cahill, an Irish tenor, Savannah Children's Choir, and Savannah Brass Quartet. Some very much Christmas and holiday stuff, but of course not everything is Christmas-oriented here in the next few days. There is a District 1 Alderman Town Hall meeting today at 6:30 p.m. at the Civic Center. And District 1 Alderman Van Johnson is holding a follow-up town hall meeting. On the agenda, pretty much, are the fire fee, the controversial fire fee, I guess we should say, public safety matters, the new arena, and other things that are of interest and going on in the city. So that's 6:30 tonight, District 1 Alderman Town Hall meeting. I'm sure there's more. There's always more in this fine city. So much stuff going on. We should say perhaps that also 15th through 17th Collective Face Theater Ensemble is performing Harvey, 8 p.m. At the Kennedy Fine Arts Center, Savannah State Theater, brownpapertickets.com. Also, Saturday evening, the Federation of the Blind is having their Christmas banquet, the National Federation of the Blind of Chatham County Christmas banquet, 7 p.m. to 16th at Carrie Hilliard's Restaurant, 11111 Abercorn Street. All right, it's going to be a kind of an all-you-can-eat type thing. If you're interested, Lucy Palmer at 912-233-5639. Let's see, what else have we got? We've got on Saturday the celebrity wrap-off for Greenbrier, Greenbrier Children's Center's Gift Wrap Center. It's going to hold its celebrity wrap-off at 2 p.m. at Oglethorpe Mall in the Macy's Department Store Court. Celebrities will dress in holiday costume and perform rap songs incorporating seasonal messages and include lyrics about Greenbrier's mission. Check at greenbriarchildrenscenter.org. GreenbrierChildrensCenter.org. Also, there will be Colonial Christmas at Wormslow. 1 to 4 p.m. December 16th, caroling, burning of the Yule log, dancing, various kinds of holiday measures typical of the colonial period. Obviously a family-friendly thing. Very reasonable price, 912-353-3023. Okay. That is going on as well. Let me also say that thank goodness the well, let me see if I can throw one or two more quick things out there. The Exchange Club of Savannah. Okay. And Mondays at noon, they meet, and their mission essentially is to support, serve, and encourage the best teachers, students, firefighters, crime fighters, leaders, and organizations in our community. The website, SavannahExchange.org, and a phone number, 441-6559. Also, I will just say that I am so very happy that we have at least delayed the design, the design that was put forward for the courthouse annex. What are they thinking? It's meant to replace that god-awful, you know, bathroom tile building that they have over there, or buildings that they have over there. And everybody raised a hue and cry. And so now they are going to work a little more closely with the Historic District Board of Review and Historic Savannah Foundation, Downtown Business Association, Telfair Museums, Georgia Trust for Historic Preservation, and others to get input into this thing before we make the same kind of ridiculous, horrible mistake that was made in 1985, 1986 with those bathroom tile buildings. So I'm certainly happy that we're going to be looking at that. I certainly hope we can completely get something entirely different than what they came up with. I don't understand why it should be so difficult to come up with a design that is at least somewhat symbiotic and respectful of Savannah's historic heritage. Hopefully we will accomplish that. All right, just about done for the day. It is just about time for background briefing. I do appreciate you listening to Savannah Lexicon here on WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings, community radio with global soul. Make it a good day.